Rock of ages, cleft for me, let me hide myself in thee. Let the water and the blood from thy wounded side, which flowed, be of sin a double cure. Save from wrath and make me pure. Welcome tonight to Madison Avenue Baptist Church. Welcome especially to those of you who are guests. We are blessed by your joining with us here tonight. You're joining your voices with ours and your hearts with ours here in this service. Tonight, over the next hour, we will memorialize our Lord's sacrifice for us, for each of us, for everybody out there, for the whole world, and as through scripture and song, we will recall the sacrifice made on our behalf. Now let us begin with a call to worship. If you would join reading responsively with me, as printed in our order of worship. Good Friday is not a day of safe distances. It is a day to stand alone in the fire.
We gather here from the hilltops and low places, from every tribe, language, nation, and race.
We watch as the shadow of death descends, as taunts and jeers echo vigil at the cross, and await the coming of the Lord. Our opening hymn this evening is number 211, Jesus Walked This Lonesome Valley. Let us all stand as we are able and sing together hymn number 211. Let us pray. Gracious and holy Lord, as we walk this lonesome valley, as we hear these words, as we sing these songs, we pray that your Spirit will be upon us, that distractions will be driven out of this place, that we will be inspired by you, O Lord, by these words. Indeed, O Lord, we don't just pray that your Spirit is here with us. We pray that in the power of your Spirit, we might be transported there to that hot hillside outside of Jerusalem to see the sights, to hear the cries, to know the love that hung there for us. And even so, O Lord, having been blessed by you here and having been transported there, we pray that you will indeed move our hearts to respond to that love and to reflect it to to our neighbors. All these things we ask in Christ's holy name. Amen.
Jesus prays in Gethsemane. They went to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, "Sit here while I pray." He took with him Peter and James and John and began to be distressed and agitated. And he said to them, "I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and keep awake." And going a little farther, he threw himself on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. He said, "Abba, Father, for you all things are possible. Remove this cup from me, yet not what I want, but what you want." He came and found them sleeping, and he said to Peter, "Simon, are you asleep? Could you not keep awake 1 hour? Keep awake and pray that you may not come into this time of trial. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak." And again he went away and prayed, saying the same words. And once more he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were very heavy, and they did not know what to say to him. He came a third time and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? Enough, my betrayer is at hand."
Souls in danger, bodies broken, trouble here and everywhere, arms that can't reach where they want to, somehow make it through whispered prayers,
whispered prayers.
Ooh.
his name. When we speak them, there is power in whispered praise.
And even as Jesus said this, Judas, one of the 12 disciples, arrived with a crowd of men, armed with swords and clubs. They had been sent by the leading priests and elders of the people. The traitor Judas had given them a prearranged sign. You will know which one to arrest when I greet him with a kiss. So Jesus came straight to Judas. "Greeting, Rabbi," he exclaimed, and gave him the kiss. Jesus said, "My friend, go ahead and do what you have come for." The other grabbed Jesus and arrested him. But one of the men with Jesus pulled out his sword and struck the high priest's slave, slashing off his ears. "Put away your sword," Jesus said to him. "Those who use the sword will die by the sword. Don't you realize that I could have asked my Father for thousands of angels to protect us, and he would send them instantly? But if I did, how would the scriptures be fulfilled that described what must happen now?" Then Jesus said to the crowd, "Am I some dangerous revolutionary that you come with swords and clubs to arrest me? Why don't you arrest me in the temple? I was there preaching every day. But this is all happening to fulfill the words of the prophet, as recorded in the scripture." At that point, all the disciples deserted him and fled.
In this world I walk alone, with no place to call my home. One who holds my hand, the rugged road through barren lands, the way is dark, the road is steep, but he's become my eyes to see, the strength to climb, my grief to bear. The Savior lives inside me there. In your love I find release, a haven for all my unbelief. Take my life and let me be God, to thee. In these trials of life I find another voice inside my mind. He comforts me and bids me live inside the love the Father gives. In your love I find release, a haven for all my unbelief. Take my take my life and let me be a living prayer, my God, to
Mark, Jesus to the high priests and all the chief priests, the elders and the scribes were all assembled. Peter had followed him at a distance, right into the courtyard of the high priest, and he was sitting with the guards, warming himself at the fire. Now the chief priests and the whole council were looking for testimony against Jesus to put him to death, but they found none. For many gave false testimony against him, and their testimony did not agree. Some stood up and gave false testimony against him, saying, "We heard him say, 'I will destroy the temple that is made with hands, and in 3 days I will build another, not made with hands.'" But even on this point, their testimony did not agree. Then the high priest stood before them and asked Jesus, "Have you no answer? What is it that they testify against you?" But he was silent and did not answer. Again, the high priest asked him, "Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One?" Jesus said, "I am, and you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming with the clouds of heaven." Then the high priest tore his clothes and said, "Why do we still need witnesses? You have heard his blasphemy. What is your decision?" All of them condemned him as deserving death. Some began to spit on him, to blindfold him, and to strike him, saying, "Prophecy." The guards also took him and beat him.
Jesus called me a hypocrite when I said that I believed. He said, "How can you follow me without a willingness to leave? Leave the gates and the passwords known to just your kind. Walk beyond the divisions that religions always find, and be the mercy my people need, the peace. This bring them relief. I love them beyond belief. Jesus called me a hypocrite when I said I'd spread the word. He said, how can you teach of love unless you live what you have heard? Hear the voice of the people crying out in pain, pain caused by dominion and fighting in my name, and be the mercy. My people need the peace. Your fight over faith won't bring them relief. I love them beyond belief. Jesus called me a hypocrite when I said that I was saved. He said, how will your soul be judged with all the judgments you have made? Faith can't be your fortress, arrogant with pride. Come walk here beside me with the humble ones outside. You must be the mercy. My people need the peace. This fight over faith won't bring them relief. I love them. Be the mercy. My people need the peace. This fight.
Peter denies Jesus. While Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the servant girls of the high priest came by. When she saw Peter warming himself, she stared at him and said, "You also were with Jesus, the man from Nazareth." But he denied it, saying, "I do not know or understand what you are talking about." And he went out into the forecourt. Then the cock crowed. And the servant girl, on seeing him, began again to say to the bystanders, "This man is one of them." But again, he denied it. Then after a little while, the bystanders again said to Peter, "Certainly, you are one of them, for you are a Galilean." But he began to curse, and he swore an oath, "I do not know this man you are talking about." At that moment, the cock crowed for the second time. Then Peter remembered that Jesus had said to him, "Before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times." And he broke down and wept.
Dear Mr. God, I'm writing you today because it seems like lately I've forgotten how to pray. I know, but everybody likes to get a letter now and then. I'm sorry for not writing more, 'cause I need you, but it's hard to see why anyone as big as you needs anything from me. I know you're there. So how you been? I'm all right, but I can't lie. Sometimes I feel like giving in. You're all I've got, dear Mr. God. Sometimes I wish you lived next door, so over coffee you could tell me what you started all this for. I guess you saw that sunrise yesterday. Thanks for the reminder that you haven't gone away. It gives me hope. Telling you what you already know, I need you, but it's hard to see why anyone as big as you needs anything from me. I know you're there, so how you been? I'm all right, but I can't lie. Sometimes I feel like giving in. Dear Mr. God, tell me, do you ever cry when we forget to thank you for the good things in our lives? I know I can. Why you do the things you do, but I know in the end I'll make it through. If I stand next to you, so here I am. Dear Mr. God, I'm writing you today because it seems like lately I've forgotten how to pray.
Jesus' trial before Pilate. Now Jesus was standing before Pilate, the Roman governor. "Are you the king of the Jews?" the governor asked him. Jesus replied, "You have said it." But when the leading priests and the elders made their accusations against him, Jesus remained silent. "Don't you hear all these charges they're bringing against you?" Pilate demanded. But Jesus made no response to any of the charges, much to the governor's surprise. Now it was the governor's custom each year during the Passover celebration to release one of the prisoners to the crowd, anyone they wanted. This year there was a notorious prisoner, a man named Barabbas. As the crowd gathered before Pilate's house that morning, he asked them, "Which one do you want me to release to you, Barabbas or Jesus, who is called the Messiah?" He knew very well that the religious leaders had arrested Jesus out of envy. Meanwhile, the leading priests and the elders persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas to be released and for Jesus to be put to death. So the governor asked again, "Which one of these two do you want me to release to you?" The crowd shouted back, "Barabbas." Pilate responded, "Then what should I do with Jesus, who is called the Messiah?" They shouted back, "Crucify him." "Why?" Pilate demanded. "What crime has he committed?" But the mob roared even harder, "Crucify him." Pilate saw that he wasn't getting anywhere and that a riot was developing, so he sent for a bowl of water and washed his hands before the crowd, saying, "I am innocent of this man's blood. The responsibility is yours." And all the people yelled back, "We will take responsibility for his death, we and our children." So Pilate released Barabbas to them. He ordered Jesus flogged with a lead-tipped whip, then turned him over to the Roman soldiers to be crucified.
Her parents never took the young girl to church, never spoke of his name, never read her his word. Two non-believers walking lost in this world took their baby with them. What a sad little girl. Her daddy drank all day, and mommy did drugs, never wanted to play or give kisses and hugs. She'd watch the TV and sit there on the couch while her mom fell asleep and her daddy went out. And the drinking and the fighting just got worse every night. Behind their couch she'd be hiding. Oh, what a sad little life. And like it always does, the bad just got worse with every slap and every curse. Until her daddy, in a drunk rage one night, used a gun on her mom and then took his life. And some people from the city took the girl far away to a new mom and a new dad, kisses and hugs every day. Her first day at Sunday school, the teacher walked in, and a small little girl stared. I don't know his name, but I know he got off, 'cause he was there in my old house and held me me close to his side. As I hid there behind our couch, the night that my parents died.
Good evening. The road to Golgotha. Some of the governor's soldiers took Jesus into their headquarters and called out the entire regiment. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him. They wove thorn branches into a crown and put it on his head. And they placed a reed stick in his right hand as a scepter. Then they knelt before him in mockery and taunted, "Hail, King of the Jews." And they spit on him and grabbed the stick and struck him on the head with it. When they were finally tired of mocking him, they took off the robe and put his own clothes on him again. Then they led him away to be crucified. They compelled a passerby who was coming in from the country to carry his cross. It was Simon of Cyrene, the father of Alexander and Rufus. Then they brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of a skull. And they offered him wine and mixed it with myrrh, but he did not take it. And they crucified him and divided his clothes among them, casting lots to decide what each should take. When they came to a place called the skull, they nailed him to the cross, and the criminals were also crucified, one on his right and one on his left.
Farmer and a teacher, a hooker and a preacher, riding on a midnight bus bound for Mexico. One was headed for vacation, one for higher education. The two of them were searching for lost souls. That driver never ever saw the stop sign. And 18-wheelers can't stop on a dime. There are three wooden crosses on the right side of the highway. Why there's not four of them, heaven only knows. I guess it's not what you take when you leave this world behind you, it's what you leave behind you when you go. That farmer left a harvest, a home and 80 acres, the faith and love for growing things in his young son's heart. And that teacher left her wisdom in the minds of lots of children. Did her best to give them all a better start. That preacher whispered, "Can't you see the promised land?" as he laid that blood-stained Bible in that hooker's hands. There are three wooden crosses on the right side of the highway. Why there's not four of them, heaven only knows. I guess it's not what you take when you leave this world behind you, it's what you leave behind you when you go. That's the story that our preacher told last Sunday, as he held that blood-stained Bible up
for all of us to see. He said, bless the farmer and the teacher and that preacher who gave this Bible to my mama, who read it to me. There are three wooden crosses on the right side of the highway. Why, there's not four of them. Now I guess we know. It's not what you take when you leave this world behind you. It's what you leave behind you when you go. There are three wooden crosses on the right side of the highway.
Jesus on the cross. Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they're doing. And the soldiers gambled for his clothes by throwing dice. The people passing shouted abuse, shaking their heads in mockery. Look at you now, they yelled at him. You said you were going to destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days. Well then, if you are the Son of God, save yourself and come down from that cross. The leading priests and the teachers of the religious law and the elders also mocked Jesus. He saved others, they scoffed, but he can't save himself. So he is the King of Israel, is he? Let him come down from the cross right now, and we will believe in him. He trusted God, so let God rescue him now if he wants him. For he said, I am the Son of God. Even the revolutionaries who were crucified with him ridiculed him in the same way.
He's having his sandwich, his chips and Baby Ruth, putting them back in the sack his mama packed with a sticker that says Jesus loves you. He's hopping on the bus, running in the house, talking to mom about his day, hiding that paper sack in a baseball glove, riding his bike straight to the freeway, where there's an old man with a shopping cart, a dirty face and a purple heart, who's saying, son, you'll never know how much this will give me food to eat if I were hungry too. Wouldn't you do this for me? Tonight the little boy's dad is flying down the freeway. It's pouring rain as he leaves the road. He's rolling down that concrete bank through the flames and the broken glass. An old man takes his hand, helps him pull him out best as you can. Now the bum that lives beneath the bridge pulls him safely from that flooding ditch. Man says, why'd you risk your life to save mine? And he said, wouldn't you do this for me? Wouldn't you help me if you could? Wouldn't you try to save my life if I needed you to? Wouldn't you do this for me? And as he's lying in that hospital bed, he's praying a silent prayer. And he can't help but ask him, Lord, did you put that beggar there? As the nurse pulls back the curtain, all he sees is a billboard sign. a 60-foot Jesus hanging on the cross. At the bottom, there's just one line. Wouldn't you do this for me? Wouldn't you do this for me? Wouldn't you?
Criminals speak to Jesus. One of the criminals hanging beside him scoffed. So, you are the Messiah, are you? Prove it by saving yourself and us, too, while you're at it. But the other criminal protested. Don't you fear God even when you have been sentenced to die? We deserve to die for our crimes, but this man hasn't done anything wrong. Then he said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus replied, I assure you, today you will be with me in paradise.
I stood in the courtroom, the judge turned my way.
It looks like you're guilty, now what do you say?
I spoke up, Your Honor, I have no defense. But that's when mercy walked in.
Ooh, mercy walked in and pleaded my case. Called to the stand, God's saving grace. The blood
there in wonder, how could this be?
Someone so guilty and just been set free.
My chains were broken, I felt born again.
The moment that mercy walked in, oh, mercy walked in and pleaded my case.
Called
to stand, God saving grace.
That covered
Jesus dies on the cross. Jesus knew that his mission was now finished. And to fulfill scripture, he said, "I am thirsty." A jar of sour wine was sitting there. So they soaked a sponge in it, put it on a hyssop branch, and held it up to his lips. When Jesus had tasted it, he said, "It is finished." Then he bowed his head and released his spirit.
Cherish the cross.
Jesus is laid in the tomb. This all happened on Friday, the day of preparation, the day before the Sabbath. As evening approached, Joseph of Arimathea took a risk and went to Pilate and asked for Jesus' body. Joseph was an honored member of the high council, and he was waiting for the kingdom of God to come. Pilate couldn't believe that Jesus was already dead, so he called for the Roman officer and asked if he had died yet. The officer confirmed that Jesus was dead, so Pilate told Joseph he could have the body. Joseph bought a long sheet of linen cloth. Then he took Jesus' body down from the cross, wrapped it in the cloth, and laid it in a tomb that had been carved out of the rock. Then he rolled a stone in front of the entrance.
It's not easy trying to understand how the world can be so cold, stealing the souls of men.
Cloudy skies rain down on all your dreams.
You wrestle with the fear and doubt. Sometimes it's hard,
but you gotta believe there's a better place where our Father waits. Every tear He'll wipe away. The darkness will be gone. The weak shall be strong. Hold on to your faith. There will come a day.
Wars are raging, lives are scattered, innocence is lost, and hopes are shattered. The old are forgotten,
the children are forsaken.
In this world we're living in, is there anything sacred?
There's a better place where our Father waits. Every tear He'll wash away. The darkness will be gone. The weak shall be strong. Out down those golden streets,
the
We are so glad that you are here on this holy Good Friday night. I apologize for the tracks in my makeup tonight. I've been crying through the whole thing, sorry. Wow, can we please give a round of applause for Paul Stephan, our amazing band and our choir, right? Right, thank you for bringing Good Friday to us in a fresh, powerful, heartfelt way. And until we see you again, which I hope is Sunday morning for the other side of the story, may God bless you and keep you, and may the God of the ever-present crosses walk with you from this day and forevermore. Amen.